I'm sure you've read newspaper articles and seen Facebook stories about students that have been restrained and/or secluded at school. And it's heartbreaking. It's maddening that our kids are still being treated in this way in so many schools around our country. And today we're going to hear a story of Guy Stevens' son, Cooper. But not only listening to this story is going to be helpful, we want you to take action at the end of this. And actually, you can start taking action now. You can hit your share button because I'm sure you know some other folks that would love to hear about and what they can do to prevent restraint and seclusion. So, Guy Stevens is our special guest today, and I met Guy on a Facebook group, really. That's how a lot of us get connected and start networking. Guy is from Maryland in the DC area, and he has a son, Cooper, who loves to collect sea glass. And I told him, I want to buy some of that sea glass because I do not have the eye for finding it, and his son does. But Guy, after his son's mistreatment and restraint and seclusion at school, formed an organization called the Alliance Against Seclusion and Restraint. Guy is the executive director of that, and it's really amazing to see the amount of work and the group that he has formed to move forward with policy changes, with making sure, even on a federal level, that we make changes. And so Guy's going to share, like I said, his son's story, and he's going to also share tips on how we, as parents and educators, can influence change and make sure that we end restraint and seclusion. So, one thing before we get started, I wanted to let you know. I'm going to say hi to Cynthia and Karen. Glad you guys are here. Cynthia is a COPPA member from, is it North Carolina, Cynthia? I think so. And Karen is from Colorado. But if you guys would love a sample letter that you could use to make sure that the school knows that you are requesting that there be no restraint of your child. If you'd like that sample letter, plus a lot of other resources that Guy has for us, just type in the word better in the comments, and hopefully my IEP bot is awake and will respond to you. So let's start talking with Guy. And Guy, what else would you like to share with our audience as far as some background? And then we can get into your son's story.
Sure. And I guess to a large part, one of the things that I think in terms of my background is this isn't about me. This is about a lot of kids out there that really need a voice. And I started the Alliance Against Seclusion and Restraint not because I had a lack of or a wealth of free time in my life and I needed a hobby, but it was due to what personally happened to our family, and it's grown tremendously. My professional life, of course, I've got a full-time job and a full-time dad and lots of other things going on. But I value my kids and my family tremendously and want to do all I can to advocate for them. So I often say I'm just the dad, but at the same time, using the power of advocacy and connecting with others, we can influence change. So the more interesting part of the story is probably to tell you a little bit about what got me moving down this direction. And I always started in the same way, which is whether I'm talking to you or whether I'm talking to a congressional representative or somebody at the Board of Education, that I started this journey because of my son. My son Cooper is 14 years old now. He loves to go to the beach. He loves to collect sea glass. He loves the He collects road signs. He loves science. He loves nature. Fantastic kid. He is autistic. He's also has ADHD and anxiety, but he's an absolutely amazing kid. And of course, would do anything I can to help him be successful, like so many of our parents that are out there and part of your community. my journey into all of this began, and I'm going to try to, as I mentioned when I talked to you earlier, there's all different versions of our story. I'm going to try to be fairly concise here, but at the same time, tell you some of the details that I think are important, which was that, you know, our journey began, you know, very young for Cooper, not with a diagnosis, but with some challenges that he had. And they began to really surface around the first grade when he went into a general education classroom setting with a lot of other children and suddenly began to experience some difficulty. He was getting overwhelmed and ending up under the desk or eloping and hiding in a hallway. He was clearly having some difficulty, and we knew we needed to figure out how to help him be successful. And we worked with the IEP team, we worked with the school, we worked with his medical team, and eventually realized that he qualified for services as a child on the autism spectrum. And we went through the process of evaluation and all of that. But where that led is it led us to an environment that we had in our county, which was something called the IEL program. It was an intensive structured learning environment, smaller class setting in a general education school, but in a standalone classroom. And the great thing was that at the time, it was what he needed to be successful. And he actually was successful from first grade until fifth grade. He did really well. In fact, so well that by the middle of fifth grade, he was in inclusion, but all but one of his classes. So certainly the journey that you're hoping to see is kind of, you know, moving on and getting the skills and the capabilities that he needed to be successful. Unfortunately, in the end of fifth grade, he had been working with a teacher, fantastic educator, for a couple of years. And she was involved in an automobile accident and didn't return to the classroom. And when that happened, he kind of lost his anchor. He lost some of his support and began to struggle. And that struggle led to behaviors and challenges we hadn't seen for 4 or 5 years, like eloping and, you know, kind of running off and hiding. And on two occasions at the end of fifth grade, he got overwhelmed. He ran off. He hid in a bathroom. He eventually came out. Then he was restrained and dragged down a hallway and put into an empty classroom. And I can't tell you how traumatic it was on him, but I'll explain to you the impact it had, which was he didn't want to go back to school. And we worked really hard to finish off that school year, and it was difficult. We got to summertime. We worked at an IEP. We were very thoughtful of what had happened. You know, I'll tell you that those instances of restraint were never identified as such. You know, never did anybody say that we restrained your child or secluded your child. It was there was a safety concern, and this is what we did. I never heard the terms restraint and seclusion in relation to a school before. Wouldn't have been anything I imagined that happened, to be honest with you. So that summer, after a lot of soul searching, you know, we developed an IEP, but Cooper didn't want to go back to school. And we ended up homeschooling him for 2 years. And this is a big issue because there are a lot of people like us that, you know, our children don't want to go back. We've lost our faith in their ability to meet his needs, that drop out of the system. You know, we're guaranteed a free and appropriate public education, but when your child is being traumatized, sometimes people go to alternatives like homeschooling. And while that was something that in my family we could do, we made sacrifices, we made changes, and we made that happen, not everyone's able to do that. You know, people are sometimes relying on, you know, multiple jobs and whatnot. So at any rate, the point being that we did end up homeschooling him. We did it for 2 years. At the end of that 2 years, he informed us that he was interested in going back to school. And part of that kind of came around the fact that we had started a little scouting group and he was seeing some of his old friends again and interested in returning. So we worked really hard. This was the spring of 2018, so not that terribly long ago. We worked really hard to develop an IEP, being mindful of what had happened to him previously, to make sure that we had the supports in place, the services in place, the approach and the way of working with him. And I can assure you, I've got a background around my son that probably is, you know, 30 or 40 pages long, but the first two pages give you all the information you need to know to work with him successfully. You know, what are his stressors or triggers, or, you know, how might he look if he's becoming overwhelmed? And he's not a tough kid to work with. You know, he's really a pretty easy kid to work with, unless you're not doing it right. And, so we worked through that summer to develop an IEP and get him back in school. And we did. So in the fall of 2018, we had him ready to go back to school. He wanted to go back to school. We were nervous, but excited. He was in a new placement in our county. I live in Maryland, and I live in a county called Calvert County, and he was in a new placement there. He was in that placement for about 15 days. Over that 15 days, he was restrained and or secluded on at least 4 occasions. We think it happened more, and we have actually, you know, kind of some documentation that shows that it wasn't appropriately reported. You know, we had to ask for the reports. You know, there was a lot of denial as to what had happened. But at the end of those 15 days, there was a traumatic event where he was restrained and secluded, and he was not going to go back to school. He had no intention of going back to school. So that led us to a year of home and hospital, which might be called homebound or something else in other areas. But basically, a teacher came out to our house, worked with my student a few hours each week. And that was actually fairly successful. He had been so traumatized, he was not going to be returning to school. The home and hospital teacher, fantastic gentleman to this day, still somebody I'm in touch with. He was, I believe, about 75 years old. He had been teaching for 50 years, had worked with kids with all sorts of challenges. Never once did he have to take any kind of physical intervention with my son. Just wasn't necessary where it happened. It wasn't necessary then. But that led to a point where I knew what had happened to Cooper was wrong. I was one parent that had a very bad experience, but very isolated. You know, if you're the member of a special education community, you're a smaller, you're a minority subset of people. And as we go into, you know, things like this, you're a smaller subset. You know, I didn't immediately know other people that had been through this. I just knew we had had a bad experience. And, you know, my story really began in all of this when I sat actually in this room with my son sitting on the corner of the bed. And I looked at him and I said to him, I said, you know, Cooper, what happened to you should never have happened. It was not okay. It was not right. You know, you did not deserve this. And I'm going to do anything within my power to make sure it doesn't happen to you again and doesn't happen to anyone else. And from that moment, I started researching, digging into this issue, looking at scientific journals, looking at news, looking at data, trying to understand the scope of this. And I was quickly finding out it was a much bigger problem than I initially thought. And as I looked at my local level and I looked at my state and my county, I made connections with someone who was able to generate a report or send me a copy of a report that was the first of its kind in our state. Our state in 2017 passed a legislation requiring seclusion restraint data to be reported to the state level. Of course, there had been data reported to the federal government through the Office of Civil Rights since 2009, but this was a first-time requirement at the state level. And I got this report before it was actually released publicly, and I analyzed the data. And I quickly learned in analyzing the data that our county was number one in the use of seclusion and number two in the use of restraint in the state. Mind you, we're about the 16th in terms of population. So that told me I'm not just one parent with a problem, but there's a systemic issue here going on in our school system that needed to be addressed. So, you know, in looking at that, I talked to somebody in the press who wrote a story about us. I began reaching out to disability organizations like Disability Rights Maryland. I reached out to COPA, who was very supportive as well. University professors. I began to kind of try to get help, and then ultimately addressed the Board of Education and asked that, you know, something be done about this. After a lot of effort, they agreed to form a committee and invited me to be part of it to look at the policies related to restraint and seclusion in our county. I will tell you that although we had a positive outcome, that process was not easy. That first meeting I went to, I was sitting across the table from someone who had restrained my child. Very difficult situation to be in. I also went to that with documentation, you know, probably about an inch and a half thick of all the research that I had been compiling to that point. And in terms of the local level, worked very hard over the last spring and summer. And we ultimately developed a new policy which aims to reduce the use of restraint and eliminate the use of seclusion within 2 years. We have introduced new ways of working with children as well as part of that and more accountability for the school system. So we've ended up in our local level with a new policy, and the school is now piloting two programs. One is something called UCARO, which I'll try to talk about a little bit later, and the other is something called Collaborative Proactive Solutions. The point here, and we'll circle back to this, is there are alternatives to seclusion and restraint that don't cause a trauma, don't risk the injury or even death that seclusion and restraint can risk. So we had a lot of luck locally, but I've always known that this was a local issue, a state issue, and a federal issue. And I've been involved with kind of efforts, you know, around that as well, you know, through the formation of the alliance. So that was the
beginning. Let me ask the viewers, if you're watching live or on the replay, do you know what your local school district's policy is on restraint and seclusion? Do you know if you even have a local policy? I'm in Idaho, and there's no state law about seclusion and restraint. Some districts in Idaho have developed their own policy, you know, statements from the Board of Education. But I really encourage parents to look into it, to get a copy of it, to read it, to ask questions, to see how it can be stronger. So I don't know, Guy, if you, you know, would there be a way that you could share it with me and I can send it out to people as far as like your district statement or your district's policy? I mean, would that be helpful for people?
Yeah, I'm happy to provide any resources I can to anyone out there that is interested in impacting a positive change. And that gets to why we started the Alliance. You know, so yes, absolutely, I can make resources available for people. What I will tell you, though, is that I happen to live in a state, Maryland, that actually has a very strong law. So laws are helpful, but there are problems with oversight and accountability, and I'll try to touch on that a little bit later. So there's a lot of awareness that needs to happen around this issue. But you're right, a really good place to start. And typically if people reach out to me, I ask that question, you know, what is your policy? What is your state law? And the funny thing is, in our case, I actually found it very early on that our county's policy was not compliant with state law. So state law had a higher standard for which the use of seclusion could be considered. And our county had a lower standard. They were out of compliance. Of course, there tends not to be accountability and oversight to that. So there's no consequence sometimes to some of those things, which is really frustrating.
Right. And Karen from Colorado says, how do we find out if there's a policy?
So typically, I have two things to share with you on that. Typically, where I start is Google. So I will go to Google and I will type, I'll often type my state, or if I know a district, I might type that. But I would start out with Colorado seclusion and restraint policy or law. And typically that will lead you to something. If you're not able to find it in that way, there are disability law centers in every state. There are ones that can probably point you to that information. And I can share some of that information later, how you would connect with that. I'll tell you, we're working on a project. And that project is to compile a page that has links to all of the state laws so that people can more easily find them. I will say there is a document out there. You can search for how safe is my schoolhouse, I believe it is. Right. And that particular document was compiled by somebody in Virginia. And it talks about the laws throughout the various states. You've got to kind of drill through it and look at the different sections, but there's a lot of information in that. I would recommend when you open it, do a search for the name of your state, and you can kind of scan through the document and find the information. So it is out there, and it's a great place to start, because you need to know, you know, is your school even complying with state law? Don't assume that they are. It may not be the case.
Right. And I know, Karen, and I can put the link in the comments after the show, but I was working for Peak Parent Center when Colorado passed their first law for restraint and seclusion, and the Parent Training and Information Center, we did have input, and, you know, I was able to testify at the State Board of Ed. It didn't go as far as I would have liked, as far as at the time it didn't prevent or whatever, like exclude prone restraints, you know, which was to me really important. It might have, you know, been amended to do that. So Karen, I can give you the link to the Colorado one. And then the school one, you could just call up your school district and ask, I'm curious if we have one, can you send me a copy of it? You know,
they're often available online. A lot of the school districts now are using software that is very similar. So you'll go and you can find the policies. If you don't mind, there's a number of great questions here, and I can continue to tell you the story, but I see a number of great questions. If you don't mind, if I hit on a couple of those.
Yeah, which, and I can.
A couple of things. There was a statement there by, I think it was Kylie, who talked about in North Carolina, the policy being vague and allowing restraint to teach a skill. And one of the things I want to say is that it's amazing how specific things can be in writing, and yet how vaguely they can be interpreted. So in Maryland, you know, one of the things that happened, we have no federal law in place that, protects kids in a school against seclusion and restraint. We do have federal law when it comes to mental health facilities. We have federal law when it comes to law enforcement, but nothing in an education setting. So that's interesting, especially when you consider that it really is a civil rights issue. We see about 70% of the kids impacted are children with disabilities. So, you know, when it comes to policy, it may seem very specific. Maryland followed federal guidance that came out in, I think it was 2014, if I'm not mistaken. There was a federal resource document, 15 principles, kind of the federal government saying, here we think is the best of what we know about restraint and seclusion. And much of it discouraged the use of restraint and seclusion, said that they, you know, they're kind of not practices that are meant to be used for discipline, and they don't have an educational value. One of the things they mentioned in there is that it should only be used when there's a case of serious, you know, physical harm. And in Maryland, we follow that guidance, and our law says that you should only be using restraint or seclusion in a situation that involves imminent serious physical harm. Imminent serious physical harm has a definition, which basically is life or death or serious bodily injury. It is a very high standard. It is intentionally high because using seclusion and restraint leads to significant trauma in the kids, teachers, and staff. So it's a very traumatic event. And the more you traumatize a person, you know, if you do the research into trauma, and I know you've talked about that before, you do the research into trauma, you know, the more you're traumatized, you get physiological changes in the brain, the more likely you are to respond to something in a fight or flight mode in the future. So in Maryland, even though our law specifically said imminent serious physical harm, people in our committee initially were very like, well, I don't know what that means. What does that mean? I'm like, well, we have a definition here. Like, well, it doesn't say the definition where it says this over here. And I'm not sure that's what they mean. And then suddenly there can be a lot of wiggle room. And we had a lot of debate about it because our State Department of Education had in previous documentation included a definition for it and later took it off their website. And my school district said, well, they took it off their website, it must not exist anymore. And I said, no, I've talked to the State Department. It's still current guidance. But the point being is that even if it's not vague, it can be interpreted in many different ways. So you've got to be very careful. And that's why when we do push for legislative efforts, we need to be as specific as we can and include definitions that can be clearly understood. Otherwise, it leaves a lot of wiggle room. So that was just something that jumped out at me that I saw in the comments here.
Yeah, for sure. And I think for parents to use those advocacy skills that you have. So when you review your child's IEP, you pay attention to the details and the specific, you know, how specific the language is. You've got to be that same kind of detective, critic, whatever, when you read board policy or, you know, statutes or regulations, because there is tremendous, you know, there are, I guess, the potential for big loopholes, and districts will take advantage of that.
Right.
You know, I was really surprised here in Idaho, our largest school district in the state has a restraint and seclusion policy. And when I asked as an advocate, because I was helping a family whose child had been restrained, I asked to see a copy of it. And I was like so surprised at the very end of this policy, it has this sentence that says parents can deny the ability for the school to use this restraint or seclusion on their child. And you have, but hardly any parents are told that at an IEP meeting. Mm-hmm. So unless you had read that policy, read all of it to the very end, you would have never known that you really had the right to give permission or to deny any kind of, you know, permission for your child to be restrained and secluded. So I was pretty surprised with that.
Yeah. Well, in Maryland, we now have a similar clause that gets on having consent. The problem is that basically what it ends up saying is that you can either consent to refuse the consent or do nothing. But regardless, if the criteria meets the legal standard, they can still use it. So it's a really interesting. And at one point there was an issue in Maryland where they were including it in the IEP and using it for other reasons. And that wasn't the intent of the law. Right. And the Maryland State Department of Education recently clarified that, which is even if it's in the IEP, it still can only be used in situations that meet what is the criteria for the law. And, you know, here is the heart of the problem. If I'm assuming people out there and probably yourself have seen the recent news out of Illinois. So Illinois has been a lot of activity. There's been lately a number of articles, some great journalists really digging in deep and getting a lot of information. And if, as you read through this article, what you're finding is that, you know, these interventions are not being used according to intent. So they're being used for punishment. They're being used for very minor offenses. And as I've talked to families kind of across the country and beyond, and talked to families in my home state, you know, my home state has that imminent serious physical harm clause. So it's got to be life or death or serious bodily injury. Yet what we find in these reports that exist are, you know, kids that were non-compliant. They didn't clean up their desk when they were asked to. They were flipping a light switch on and off and not responding. They, you know, took their shoes off and refused to put them back on. They were disrespectful. You know, these are very serious interventions and are not intended to be used in that way. And I would say to you that the majority of instances that are happening are ones that really don't meet that high bar standard. You know, if you look at a school district, you know, and I'm going to take a school district like mine, it's fairly small, 16,000 students. I think we had, you know, 700 or so instances of seclusion one year, you know, hundreds of instances of restraint. These are life or death emergencies. In a school system that size, you should not be seeing this number of life or death emergencies happening across your school in that kind of time period. What's often happening is that, one, children's needs aren't being appropriately met. They're not being, they don't have the appropriate accommodations or services. They're becoming frustrated. You know, a lot of the kids are kids with disabilities. My son is autistic. And, you know, if you've worked with children that are on the autism spectrum, you may find that they are sometimes have very black and white thinking. They can be very rigid. They can be inflexible. And what happens in a school setting is that sometimes a well-meaning educator wants to impose their will on you. And as a child is escalating and becoming less and less flexible, the educator becomes less and less flexible. And sometimes well-meaning educators are actually escalating the children and leading to these situations. And, you know, we at the Alliance are not at all anti-educator. In fact, you know, we believe that we all need to work together to make a positive difference. So it's about parents, it's about advocates, it's about teachers, it's about anybody that has an interest in this issue. And we've actually published a lot of stories from educators that are doing positive things and working with their kids in positive ways. But it is a complicated problem. And you will find that, you know, it's being abused. And you know what? You know, over 10 years ago, 2009, the Government Accountability Office did a report on this, and they found seclusion restraint was being abused. Kids were being injured. Kids were being killed. There was a push for legislation that same year that failed. But we know there's an issue, and it's continuing to go on. It's beginning to get a lot more coverage in this last year or so. There's a lawsuit right now in Virginia against Fairfax County, one of the largest school districts in the country. There are, you know, the cases in Illinois. I mean, they're all over the place. So definitely a big issue here.
Yes, for sure. And so we have another question about how parents can look up restraints and seclusion reported by schools. I know that this is underreported in our schools.
Great point. So first of all, the first place to go to look for data is the Office of Civil Rights. It's Office of Civil Rights data. I can get the URL for you, but if you do OCR data, the Office of Civil Rights collects data on seclusion restraint. You can put in the name of your specific school or your district, and then you can drill down and find all sorts of data that's reported to OCR. It's not the easiest site to navigate, but if you look over on the left and right, you see a tab for discipline, and you can drill down then to seclusion restraint. It will tell you how many instances were reported. That said, there's been a lot of discussion about this. In fact, the Government Accountability Office in July, I believe it was, issued a report saying that the Department of Education needed to do a better job, that they had grave concerns about the quality of the data. They were finding that many large school districts across the country were not appropriately reporting their data. So OCR is a good place to begin. If your state has a reporting requirement of any kind, and if you look up the law, you can find that. You want to see if you can get a hold of the state data. So in Maryland now, we have a requirement. Every year there's a report that's generated. I'll tell you that, in fact, I've got the latest data. It came out in December, and the State Department of Education has not made that publicly available, but I was able to get it, and I have made it publicly available for them because I think it needs to be shared. So you may be able to find data from your state level as well. But again, keep in mind all the caveats with the data. There's a lot of concern. If you talk to a parent that, or you talk to an advocate that has worked with kids that have been restrained and secluded, I would say that for every instance that's been reported, there are many that are not. And, you know, I've read horror stories. There was a newspaper article recently I read. It was a teacher being interviewed, and she talked about in her school district, you know, they told her unless there were bruises or scratches that were visible, not to report it. So there is a real issue. And there are many states that have zero reporting requirements, and that's a problem as well. And again, civil rights should not vary as we cross state lines. Civil rights should be across the country, and there should be basic rights, you know, for our children in regards to things like restraint and seclusion that aren't a matter of where you live.
Right. And one organization, and I can give you these links. If you just type in the word better in the comments, I'll get you resources from Guy and some other resources. But one organization as a parent that you might be interested in joining is the Council of Parent Attorneys and Advocates. Cynthia is with us now. She's a COPA board member. And Guy is going to be a speaker at COPA's conference in March. But Cynthia says North Carolina has legislation. Reporting to parents is not required, only if child is restrained or secluded incorrectly or is harmed. So that's interesting.
Yeah, and when you consider the trauma, the restraint and seclusion. I mean, my child, end of fifth grade, twice was restrained, did not want to go back to school. I published a story this morning about a child that was restrained at school. And, you know, again, same kind of thing. He would get to the door and just be like, no, 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 you know, I don't want to go in. So, you know, not reporting. I mean, how do you define harmed? Because I would say that trauma is clearly harm. So if you're talking about bruises or scrapes, you're talking about the surface of harm. And I think that's a real problem. Parents need to be aware of what's happening. You know, restraint and seclusion is what it sounds like. I mean, it's physical restraint. It's using your body. It's you know, and there are different restraint techniques. But I mean, it looks like something you would expect to be happening at an arrest, not in a school. And, you know, seclusion is akin to solitary confinement when a child is put in there against their will. And again, when I talk about seclusion, I want to be clear because sometimes there's some confusion. When I'm talking about seclusion, I'm talking about child put into an area by themselves against their will and refuse the ability to leave. So it is a forceful situation. It's not go in there, take a time out. When you're ready, come out. It's we're going to put you in there against your will. We're going to hold the door shut, and you're not able to come out. We have no problem with a sensory room that's used properly, or even a child that needs a quiet space and they need a minute to you know, get a, you know, regulator, de-escalator, whatever it may be, when it's kind of self-guided and on their own. But seclusion, I mean, a parent that I'm presenting with at COPA, in fact, Heather Luke, advocate and nationally for seclusion, against seclusion restraint, works for a parent center in Maryland. Her son, Karsten, had his hand broken and part of his foot broken, being forced into a seclusion room. And, you know, I've done a lot of research on this and I've talked to a lot of people. And in all of that research and talking to, you know, people in academia and reading papers and doing a lot of research, I can find no support for the use of seclusion in an academic environment. In fact, what we find, and even Department of Education said this, that there's no therapeutic or educational value to seclusion, and that's why it's intended for crisis. But nonetheless, it tends to lead to an increase in aggression and an increase in behaviors. So what you get out of seclusion is often more seclusion. When it comes to restraint, I'll tell you that our views on it is, one, that restraint should be exceedingly rare. Restraint should not be happening frequently. In fact, there's documentation from the Office of Civil Rights to the same effect. Restraint should be something used when there is an emergency and there's no other choices and you need to use restraint to keep a child safe. And to that end, I mean, an example here that I think it would be a reasonable use of restraint would be, we've got a child that's going to dart in front of a moving bus absolutely, I want you to wrap your arms around that child and I want you to restrain that child to keep that child safe. Or you've got a child with a pair of scissors coming after another child with the intent to physically injure them. Absolutely, I want you to restrain that child and keep that child or the other child safe. There are potential times that that may be necessary, but they should be exceedingly rare. Those are those true life or death situations. They should not be happening hundreds and hundreds of times. And that's the problem. If you read the Illinois story, these practices are sometimes being abused. And part of the issue here is that, you know, we go back and it wasn't that long ago in our history that kids with disabilities weren't even allowed in public schools. And people fought really hard to make that happen. Unfortunately, when kids with some of the challenges came into our schools, they borrowed techniques from mental health and other settings like restraint and seclusion. And they began to get cemented as practices within our education world framework. And the world has changed in a lot of other areas, but some of these practices are kind of holdouts because people haven't been shown better ways to do things. I saw a comment a second ago, and I haven't read the whole thing, but it talked about teachers kind of being untrained and ill-equipped for these situations. And I would agree. Yeah, I would agree with that. That, you know, oftentimes teachers are taught these methods. So they come in, they're taught that if this happens, you do this, and that might involve restraint or seclusion. So that's the practice that they're told. And I've talked to a lot of teachers, some that do that because that's what they're told is the appropriate way to handle it. Some that intuitively think, well, gee, this isn't right. There must be a better way, and actually do find better ways of working with kids. But across the board, our schools tend to not have the appropriate type of training to avoid this. And here's the thing, we can reduce and eliminate restraint and seclusion, and there are better ways out there to do it. So there are better ways of working with kids. Trauma-informed, absolutely. Trauma-informed practices are you know, what we ultimately want to do is reduce the need for crisis management. And to do that, we need to work with the problem kind of upstream. So we need to work with, you know, in a trauma-informed way, you're working with kids upstream, you're developing relationships. Somebody just said, I love CPS, and yay, I do too. and Lives in the Balance, fantastic organization. In fact, they are also we've actually been working with them. They're also very focused on reducing and eliminating seclusion and restraint. And in fact, the system advocated by Lives in the Balance is the Collaborative Proactive Solutions Model. The couple books, The Explosive Child or Lost at School, that talk about that framework. But, you know, the philosophy there is working with kids and solving problems proactively. So, you know, the key to the Ross Green and Lives in the Balance philosophy is Ross believes that kids do well if they can. And that sounds like a really simple thing, and we all go, well, of course. But the opposite of that is what happens in schools, where we believe that kids do well if they want to. And if you believe that kids do well if they want to, when they're not succeeding, what do? Well, you try to incentivize with rewards, maybe sticker charts or some other type of incentive, or you punish. And not all kids respond to that. In fact, the kids that do respond to it probably don't need that kind of thing in the first place. And that was one of the issues with my son, was that all the sticker charts in the world weren't going to help him when he was having a tough time with something. But that collaborative proactive solutions approach kind of looks at how can we solve this problem first proactively. So most problems are repeatable. How can we solve it kind of upstream rather than waiting for crisis to happen? And how can we invite the child in and work with the child on a solution? So there are solutions. I love CPS. It's something that I believe we can implement in our schools. In fact, in our county, we are now starting a pilot with collaborative practice solutions. We went up to the conference in Maine back in November. Representatives from my county attended as well. We're really excited to start a new program there. So there are programs. CPS is a great one. Absolutely trauma-informed and kind of working with things upstream. I'll talk about one other one just real briefly, and that's something called Ukeru. Ukeru, and everybody pronounces it a little bit differently, but it was a system developed by Grafton, which is a group in Virginia that runs a number of non-public schools. So schools that were working with kids that had not been successful in kind of less restrictive settings. And Grafton had a history of using a lot of restraint and seclusion because it was what everybody did. Everybody that was working with these behaviorally challenging children were relying on restraint and seclusion because that's what they had been taught and thought were the best ways of doing it. And eventually Grafton realized they needed to do something different. And they were in fact in jeopardy of losing their workman's compensation insurance because they had so many injuries. And they had a new CEO that came in with the goal of with the goal of coming up with a better way of doing this. And they ultimately developed something called Ukeru, which is a trauma-informed alternative to restraint and seclusion. And a lot of the focus, I've actually taken the training because as I look for alternatives that I wanted to encourage people to consider, I wanted to know what I was talking about. So I actually went through the training and you know, a lot of the focus is on being trauma-informed, building relationships, building understanding. And you know, when you seclude and restrain, you destroy relationships. My son, who is now in ninth grade, still sees the man that restrained him in the fifth grade, and he has a visceral reaction. I mean, he gets really upset about it. So, you know, trauma-informed approach where you're building relationships and building trust is really great. And Ukeru has a crisis management component that uses what they call a method called blocking, which is rather than restraining a child, they have pads that they employ. And basically, if a child is coming at you aggressively, you try to work with them and get them to come down. But rather than charging at them and holding them, you kind of back away using the pad to kind of protect yourself. But also the word Ukeru is from a Japanese word that means to receive. The idea is that you know, they're able to get out a little bit of that frustration, but at the same time, you're trying to let them know, hey, I'm here for you. I'm you know, when you wrap your arms around them and hold them down, that's not saying I'm here for you. That's saying I'm going to control you. So the really important thing about all of this is that we absolutely should be reducing and eliminating restraint and seclusion where we can. And there are better alternatives. And these alternatives are safer for the students, the teachers, and the staff. We often hear from unions and superintendent unions and things like that, that, oh, well, gee, teachers need these tools to keep themselves safe. And that's a bit of a fallacy because what we find is the data shows the opposite. The more you use restraint and seclusion, the more likely it is that you're going to be injured or that you're going to injure a student or even kill a student. We've had, unfortunately, too many very sad stories about kids that have died being put in restraint. So, yeah, there are a lot of alternatives out there. Ukeru is with a U, it's a U-K-E-R-U, and it, maybe you can put a website up as well. But it's a great alternative. But again, Ukeru, you know, it's trauma informed and it's about offering an alternative to crisis management. But sometimes it's, you know, what we did in our system is we looked at kind of an approach where really what we want to do is look at the problem upstream, you know, so dealing with the problem upstream, which is a great place for something like CPS, and then replacing what we do in crisis with something like Ukeru. So you begin to put things together, and we can offer programs to schools and educators that are going to help keep everybody safer and reduce the trauma and get us heading in a better direction. I mean, ultimately, you know, this issue has multiple sides. And the flip side of this is you'll see news about, you know, kids that are more aggressive than they've ever been. They're flipping over desks, they're throwing things, they're injuring people. And very often those stories, they may not tell you, but very often they're dealing with kids that may have disabilities. And what I instantly feel from that is there's a kid that's not getting their needs met. And not to say that some kids don't need more and some might need a more restricted placement, but many people look at that and think, well, we need to get all of these kids out of our school and they want to segregate them. And of course, you know, inclusion is a beautiful thing if it's done well. And all children can benefit from inclusion. It's not just the children with disabilities, but all children can benefit. And there's a number of studies that back that up. So we've really got to be doing better.
Right. And, you know, when you talk about being more proactive and, you know, have that upstream, you know, thinking and being able to, you know, to realize in the moment, mm-hmm. you know, how the child is feeling and reacting. It reminds me of Dana Abram. I don't know if you've heard of her. She has an online course for parents and teachers, Calm the Chaos, which I just went through, and it's really, really helpful. And she talks about the spiral and, like, you know, your child doesn't just have this major meltdown. There's all these other triggers or little things that have happened. And when you get to the center of the spiral, that's where the meltdown happens. So instead, if we can identify these other triggers here, intervene and be proactive, you know, that's a strategy that teachers can use. Right. And, you know, the other article that I found on your website that's really interesting is, and I forget the title of it, but it's kind of like, what's wrong with PBIS?
Right.
Positive intervention strategies.
The problem with behaviorism. Yeah.
Yeah. And that, that is like so widely used in our classrooms. And so I'm also going to put that in the resource packet that I'll be sending everybody. But yeah, there are alternatives. And the thing that I want to also emphasize, I guess, as a former teacher, is that when we have, you know, one workshop for teachers, or pass out handouts or see a video, like there's research that kind of staff development, 0% gets implemented. Right. We really have to have that coaching and that feedback for teachers when we're expecting them to do new things.
Yeah. So this is the beauty of, again, Dr. Green, I have a lot of respect for. I think that his work helped me to have a lens change to kind of look at things a little bit differently. One of the things they do in their training at Collaborative Practice Solutions is it's not a one and done. It's over multiple weeks. And I don't remember if it's 12 or not, but it's over a number of weeks. And you actually have a mentor that you kind of work with, and you go out and you try things and you report back. And it's not just, let's have everybody here for 6 hours, you're going to learn this and you're going to get done. And oftentimes what groups will do is, before they do that, they'll do a book study. So they start out with Lost in School and they read that, and then they go through the training. So there's affordable, and it is, it's affordable training out there. But I would say, even, you know, we of course hear, you know, there's not enough money, we don't have enough resources, but I'll tell you, everybody can make a difference individually where they choose to. So I've known some amazing teachers out there and amazing advocates and parents. I have a parent right now in my county that I've been talking to quite a bit, who was a big fan of Dr. Green, and she first got his book at John Hopkins when she was in an inpatient facility with her son. And, you know, she became a big believer, and, you know, she's been working with school to work into her IEP the principles of the Collaborative Proactive Solutions approach, and is working with the teachers, and the teachers are actually excited to kind of learn a way that works with her child. So we can, even though we can't, you know, we can't hand out the dollars to everybody to make the changes happen right away, there are things that we can do to influence that change, even as parents. And somebody said something earlier, which I think is important as well. They said something about people often blame parents, and it really makes me sad, because any of us that are on this journey that have had this happen, I can assure you, I mean, I don't mean to sound the wrong way, but I'm a very involved parent. I love my kids to the end of the world and back, would do anything, and that's why I'm here. And, you know, when we have children that have disabilities, they have certain types of challenges, and there's a lot to understand about behavior. One of my other favorite, authors and researchers is a woman named Mona Della Hook, Dr. Della Hook. She has a book called Beyond Behaviors. If you can put up a link, it'd be great. She's absolutely fantastic. She recently wrote an article for our alliance as well, talking about restraint and seclusion and behavior. But, you know, she kind of gets into, there's so much, if you look at behavior as an iceberg, you know, what you see, there's so much beneath the surface. And a lot of behaviors, if you look at the classical behaviorism approach, it's, you know, it's attention seeking, it's, you know, it's sensory avoiding, sensory, you know, and it wants to break behavior down into, kind of going back to the work of, Skinner and others, of very basic fundamentals. And she advocates for the fact that there are relational safety issues. You can't learn anything unless you feel safe and secure. And, you know, she talks a lot about something called the polyvagal theory, which has to do with relational safety, and how so much of what drives behavior is what's below the surface. So there's a lot of great resources out there for us to learn more and to be more effective advocates for our children. I think I told you, one of the questions that I get commonly from people, so, you know, since we formed this group, it's only been less than a year, we've got about 4,000 people now that are part of this community. And I'm talking to people from all over the country on a regular basis that are going through this. And one of the questions is, what do I do? And I actually wrote a short article about that, like some of the steps that you can take if this is happening to you or your child or a friend's child. And, you know, maybe we can share that later. But, you know, the article is really about, What steps you should take, you know, like finding out the law, you know, finding out specifically what's happening, what organizations might be able to help you and support you. There are a number of things that you can do to make a difference. And ultimately, our group initially was formed, when I formed it in, you know, March of last year, the reason I did it is I wanted to share the information that I was finding with other people. Because what I found is I felt very alone and isolated when this happened, and I had a hard time finding resources. And then I realized, gee, other people are going to benefit from this. And one of my messages to the people out there, one is you're not alone. There are other people going through this. And the other is that we can make a difference. And that's how our mission has kind of evolved. We want to encourage people, whether they're parents, teachers, advocates, attorneys, whoever they may be, that you can make a difference. I mean, we had in my county, we made a positive policy change. But I had two meetings this week. I had one at the Maryland State Department of Education, another with a local delegate, Maryland delegate. You know, these are things that people can do. And I know we've got busy lives and busy schedules. And sometimes we just get our kids out of the situation and move on. But it's not right either that we're having to drop out of school. I encourage people to do what they can to make change. I know there's a lot of reasons that people are afraid. You know, we have seen school retaliation issues and other issues like that. But, you know, I believe we can make a positive difference.
Well, and I think that's so true. And I think, you know, some of us have different skill sets and different strengths. And so when we can widen our circle and have more allies, you know, we can find somebody that feels comfortable talking to legislators. Mm-hmm. We can find someone else that would be just fine if they could go to the school board meeting and just present there. Or, you know, so it's going to take the old thing, it takes a village, right? So don't think because, oh my gosh, I'd be scared to death to go, you know, right, testify at a legislative, you know, committee meeting or something. Find someone else that has that skill set and can do that. And just know that there are options and there are other opportunities. And what I'm thinking of now as an advocate, like, you know, when parents request a functional behavior assessment, it's almost like, oh, I don't know if we even want to go down that route because they only look at what's, you know, at that tip of the iceberg. Right. And so I always find myself at meetings saying, but why do we think he's trying to get out of doing that work? Is it because it's too easy? Right. Is it because he's tired of somebody saying, what color is this? What's this shape? Right. You know, let's look at why. Let's look at the underneath. And that discussion rarely happens, I think, at IEP meetings when we're looking at FBAs and developing behavior plans. So next Thursday, because I do this as a weekly show, next Thursday I'm going to follow up and talk about more specifically with functional behavior assessments. And like you said, how can we write in some of the collaborative problem-solving strategies into a behavior plan versus the traditional antecedent behavior consequence kind of things that we always see.
Yeah. And again, to go back to my friend, Dr. Green here, you know, and any of the believers out there will probably enjoy this, but you know, we often have that, you know, will versus skill kind of debate where, you know, my son's behavior was often seen as willful where in fact he was lagging skills. And, you know, just like with academic skills, if you don't have the adaptability skills to respond appropriately in certain situations, those are skills you need to learn. We often just want to look at it. And, you know, that's some of my concerns around behaviorism is it's often more manipulative than problem solving. And, you know, we actually had a meeting, the Alliance had a meeting up at the Department of Education. We actually met with one of the people that leads the PBIS program, you know, for the federal government. And we're hoping to have more dialogue about that. But we believe, I mean, while if you want to look at PBIS as a framework, we believe there's pieces that are missing out of that framework. And we believe that we can be doing better. We would love to see collaborative, proactive approaches and things like that. Because not all kids respond in the same way to the same things. And some of the kids that need the help the most aren't motivated by the sticker charts and the, you know, the restraint and seclusion leads them to a lower sense of safety, which leads them to be more likely to respond in maladaptive ways in the future that are going to get them in, you know, back into the same situation.
Right. And I think, you know, the other thing is when parents seek out counselors or mental health therapists to help, a lot of times those professionals don't have a very robust tool bag. I was recently at a meeting with the counselor, and one of the first things that she talked about was, well, you set down what the rules are, you talk about the consequences, it happens, there's no debate. And I'm like, What about like finding about relationships and developing that with the child first? And so what I think is hard for families is they look to the teacher. They must know they're the teacher, right? They went to school. I don't know. Maybe this is the best way they're supposed to treat kids. They look at their counselor or their therapist that says consequences, consequences, you know, and it's like, they must know they are the therapist. So it's, you know, it's that knowing that you have to start understanding some of the other options out there and really bringing that to the table when you're at IEP meetings and things like that.
Right. And don't sell yourself short. I mean, you are the expert on your child. I don't care how many degrees the people around the table have. You have more experience and you know what works and what doesn't with your child. And don't be afraid to speak up. Don't be afraid to do your own research and bring that into the school. You know, I mean, you'd be amazed at how powerful it is. And it doesn't have to be confrontational. We can work as partners. You can go into your school and say, hey, look, I read this book, Lost at School, and it really resonated with me because I realized that these are the things that work with my child. And hey, I bought a couple copies for everybody. I'd love if you'd tell me what you think about it. You know, advocate in any way you can, and don't get white coat syndrome. I mean, I often say this, we go to the doctors and people often look at the doctor and go, oh, the doctor knows all. You know, you can do your own research, because be careful with that, but you can know more than you think. And also it's your body. And when you're going to a school, you know, don't get the same thing where you look at all the educators like, well, they must know. They've got a lot they've got to know, and there are a lot of expertise there. And I'm not trying to sell that short, but I'm saying as a parent, give yourself credit. Somebody had an attack, a comment there about, and it was about parents getting kind of blamed and, you know, shamed and all of that for challenging behavior. And I get it because I was there. I mean, especially when my son was very young, you know, we've all been there. We've all been in the store and we've seen the, you know, kind of people that don't understand, you know, what we're going through. We have a scouting group now and almost all of our families have at least one neurodiverse child that is there. And it's such this environment where it's like everybody gets like, oh, yeah, this meltdown, no big deal. This happens. You know? We don't get that acceptance always out in public, and people do want to blame. You know, there's a lot of bad philosophy still out there. I mean, we still have corporal punishment happening in many states across the nation. But these things aren't helping us. I don't know if, you know, I'm throwing a plug if anybody's not seen this, but there's a film called The Kids We Lose. It was actually produced by the Lives in the Balance group and a video production company, but it's about kind of the school to prison pipeline. And our children that are getting restrained and secluded, our children that are getting suspended and expelled, are entering into the potential of the criminal justice system. So we've really got to be cognizant of getting on top of this and ensuring our kids are going to have a great future.
Right. And I wanted to share Terry's comment about, you know, the C word that I despise the most is compliance. I want to replace that with the C word of choice. But Terry says, I see too many young people having anxiety attacks because of school's insistence on compliance.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it's a great comment. I think Terry might have had another comment earlier about CPS, which is collaborative practice solutions, which really, I mean, that's one of the things that we learn about in that system is that oftentimes what leads to this is it's the demand for compliance. It's, I'm the teacher, I'm in charge, I'm going to impose my will on you, I'm going to be unflexible because that's the way it works. And you know, I think to myself, if I were a teacher, is that the hill I want to die on? Or do I want to figure out a way to successfully work with this child and have progress? But there is a mindset sometimes that's very structured that this is what the expectation is. And you know, some of our children are not getting work within a way that's really appropriate for them.
Right. Oh, exactly. So I want to thank you for being here, Guy. You know, it's like one of those things that we could just have a conversation about for hours, and there would still be more that we could dive into. So I will be gathering resources that Guy mentioned on today's episode, and also some other resources that they have on their inseclusion.org website. And I'll be emailing those out to folks on Tuesday. So if you'd like to get those, just type in the word better in the comments. but I also wanted to thank our viewers, both the live people that are here with us and the replay viewers. Keep your comments and questions coming. You know, we can come back and answer more questions in the comments on the Facebook page. Make sure that you share this with other people, because just think of all the nuggets that you just learned today in the last hour from Guy. And the more people that realize that there are alternatives to restraint and seclusion, the more children are going to be happy and learning in school versus traumatized at school. So Guy, I don't know if you have any closing words or thoughts that you would like to leave us with.
Sure. Again, just to reiterate a couple of key messages here. I think one is, you know, if you're going through this, you're not alone. There are others, but I'd certainly encourage you to seek out our website, because, you know, the Facebook group, it is designed for our community. I mean, it is about people that are there that want to see positive change. We really try hard to keep it positive. I mean, we share some of the stories about things that are really traumatic, but our goal is really to influence change. So you're not alone. You can make a difference. Where, whatever level that's at, that you can do something, you can make a difference. Even sharing your stories. You know, we publish parent stories. And you know what happens when we do is people become inspired and they're like, gee, I want to do something. I want to take action. Look what they did. And I really encourage you to share your story if you can. It can be difficult, but the payoff can be to help others. And just thank anybody that is interested in helping us make change. I mean, the bottom line is that we can and we must do better. You know, we can make our schools safer for students, teachers, and staff while reducing and eliminating restraint and seclusion. And if we can do that, we should do that. So I just want to thank anybody that's been watching and invite them to join our group. And if I can help in any way, in anything they're working on, or collaborate if they're with another group, we'd be happy to do that.
Well, thank you so much. And I just know that this discussion is going to lead to more change. So I appreciate your efforts and your energy, and it is making a difference. And I appreciate parents like you that will go forth and decide this is important enough and we're going to do something about it. So know that you have Guy in your back pocket if you need that strength when you're going to meetings or dealing with schools. And know that next week we're going to continue the conversation, a little bit of a, you know, juncture there, and we're going to be talking more about functional behavior assessments, behavior plans, and how we can incorporate some of these positive strategies, even though there's maybe not this school-wide or district-wide agreement to it, but that you can start inching your way in there and making differences for your own child. So I am Charmaine Tanner. I am thrilled that I can be here learning more from parents and self-advocates, and I hope to see you all next Thursday at noon Mountain Time here on our Facebook page. So until then, take care, and we shall talk again soon.